Well, thank you everyone for joining me today to hear about some of the work that my laboratory colleagues and I have been doing over these past several years. And I'd also like to say a particular thank you to Frederick, to Gunnar, and to Eva for being such wonderful hosts and for the invitation to this fantastic lecture series. I think you're so lucky here in Stockholm and at the Karolinska to have this Culture and Brain series. And I wish that we were so lucky in the UK and in America to have similar things. So the fact that there's a lot of interest for that is just awesome to see. So hopefully you'll learn some interesting things today. So I'd like to begin by placing some of my research questions within a much broader context. And that context is, how is it that we're able to understand other people moving around us in a social world? This is a fundamental problem for human beings, but it's something that we achieve absolutely effortlessly. We can think about countless contexts throughout our daily lives, whether it's something quite simple and mundane, such as raising your hand to ask a question in a classroom or opening a door for a friend, having a cup of tea with a friend, or very complex things such as playing a violin concerto, playing a game of rugby, building a house. Again, we can think of countless activities that range from the simple everyday to the very, very complex. And all of these, to achieve them successfully, require that we make sense of and predict and respond to other people moving around us. And there's a question, the question is, how are we able to do this without even thinking about it? If we take a really simple example, and this is an example of two friends having a cup of coffee together, the idea that's been around for really quite some time now, Aristotle was one of the first people to articulate this, and then ranging throughout history from Descartes and William James, the founder of modern psychology, all of these venerable thinkers had this idea that we're able to use kind of our perception, we're able to use our own actions to perceive and make sense of other people's actions around us. So the idea is, if you're having a cup of coffee with your friend at a cafe, you're able to understand what it is your friend does when she reaches forward and grabs a cup to bring it to her lips to drink by in some way calling upon your own experience performing that same action. Now, of course, this isn't something that we effortfully think about. It's something that happens in an automatic and implicit way. But this idea that we use our own experience to make sense of others around us is something that is an idea that's been around for a long time, and it's gained more and more experimental support and momentum over the past 20 years or so. And something that'll be quite familiar to the cognitive neuroscientists and perhaps the psychologists in the audience here is the research finding that really kind of jump-started this action perception link idea that now was back in 1996, so over 20 years ago, and this was the discovery of mirror neurons within the non-human primate brain. So for those of you who might not be familiar or might have heard what mirror neurons are but might have forgotten what they are, essentially these were a set of neurons which were discovered within the brain of this species here, which is the rhesus macaque monkey, and they were discovered by Giacomo Rizzolatti and his colleagues in Italy, actually quite by accident. So essentially, what the researchers were doing was they were studying, they had electrodes within the brain of these monkeys, and they were studying how neurons within particular brain regions, denoted here by these blue traces, were responding when the monkey was performing motor actions. So in this case, the monkey was grabbing raisins from a plate, and they were interested in the motor properties of these neurons, and they found that when the monkey performed these actions, the neuron responded in a robust manner. So this was a motor neuron, this is what they expected it to do, that's fine. But quite by accident, the same group of researchers noticed that when an experimenter was putting more raisins on the plate for the monkey to perform subsequent trials, those identical neurons were responding as well during the perception of action when the monkey just sat there quietly. So the researchers had no hypotheses or no predictions in this original instance for visual properties of these neurons. These were motor neurons, or these were a type of neuron that was involved in motor processing per se, but by simply perceiving, they saw that these same neurons responded not in an identical way, but in a similar manner. And this gave rise to this notion of monkey see, monkey do, or the same kind of neural substrates are involved in both perception and action. And just to give you a little bit of an orientation in the monkey brain, what we see here, these neurons were initially localized within the ventral premotor cortex, or area F5, and also the inferior parietal lobule. So two cortical areas that roughly sit about here and here were found to have these neurons that respond to action and perception in a really similar, biologically comparable way. So this was the first real ammunition from a neuroscientific perspective that kind of supports these ideas of Aristotle, of Descartes, and of William James, that action and perception are somehow special, that they share, they talk to each other. So with this discovery over 20 years ago of mirror neurons, there's been a lot of interest in whether similar neurons are present or active within the human brain. And there's kind of a debate that I don't really want to get into because, though it's interesting, it's not super relevant to the work that my colleagues and I do per se, but there's probably mirror neurons in the human brain. We don't have the same techniques with the human neuroscience that we use with non-human primates, but more to the point, we can talk about the existence of a mirror neuron network, or as my research team calls it, an action observation network, which does exist within the human brain and which we do find has very similar properties. I've just lost my laser pointer, sorry. Here we go. Has very similar properties for observed and executed actions. And much like you probably recall seeing in the monkey brain, this is the human brain now, the two places where we seem to see the most engagement between action and perception in the human brain are also these premotor and parietal regions. But because we're interested in perceiving actions per se, we also get kind of widespread engagement of these more temporal regions illustrated in green in the cartoon brain there. So this idea that, again, was really kickstarted with the discovery of mirror neurons in the mid-90s and has been gaining more and more research attention over the past 20 years, is this idea that actions are understood by perhaps directly matching those that we see others do onto our own motor system. And this is what enables us to effortlessly make sense of others around us. So using that as a bit of context, I'd like to tell you how my team and I have been using dance, among other things, to really probe this relationship between perception and action. So if we take a very simple box and arrow diagram here, and we have this we have perceptual analysis on one side, and we have action understanding or motor output, so essentially vision and action, or perception and action, on both sides of our model. We know that motor resonance, this idea that kind of when I see you do an action, my own motor system's helping me to understand that via motor resonance, this is what's helping to link these two. And we know that this is achieved in brain regions which are broadly termed the action observation network. So again, we have premotor, parietal, and occipitotemporal cortices that compose this network. What my research team and I have been trying to do over the past 12 years or so is to really ask questions about this bidirectional link between perception and action having to do with experience. So how is experience shaping this relationship? And we've looked at a bunch of different types of experience over the past several years, from physical, visual, social, aesthetic, auditory, and linguistic. There's a lot of different types of experience we've kind of thrown at this system and trained people on to see what happens. And I'm not going to talk about all those today, but I'll highlight a few of those types of experience and how we've kind of probed them to better understand how both perception and action are linked within the human brain. And in terms of the approaches we've taken to addressing this, we've looked at several different types of neuroscience methods. So we do make coordinated use of functional neuroimaging, brain stimulation, and lots of behavioral measures to help us construct a more complete picture of experience-dependent plasticity. We also are big fans of the longitudinal and training study in my laboratory. So these are very intensive. They take a lot of work to run and to put together, as many people will know here with the music types of studies that you do. But by using intensive training interventions and cross-sectional and longitudinal approaches, this also enables us to more precisely quantify learning-dependent changes or learning-related changes in both people's brain activity and what they're able to do. And finally, we have a focus on skilled and unusual actions in the laboratory. We tend to focus on action experts like dancers and gymnasts and contortionists, and also how we perceive more unusual actors or actions, such as non-human agents, robots, and avatars. And this enables us to explore the flexibility of these action and perception links and how they not only change with experience, but how they're able to kind of accommodate a broad range of things that are either familiar or unfamiliar to us that we either can do or can't do with our own bodies. So just to unpack that last point in a little more detail, you might say again, okay, you said that you study these dancers and acrobats and contortionists. Why would you study such complex actions? And I think, well, this is the answer I will provide anyways. I think it's a good justification. If you're familiar with this field of experience-dependent plasticity and action perception links, you'll know that the majority of action learning and action observation studies really focus on small constrained movements of the hands and fingers and wrists. And obviously, for those of you studying music, there's good reason, because these are the effectors that make music happen. But also in kind of non-music contexts as well, people study lots of button pressing and knob turning and these types of things. There's a great reason for this. If you're doing brain scanning studies, you can actually have people perform these actions in the scanner. So this has established a lot of the knowledge that we know about action perception links, and that's fantastic, and there's a great utility to that. However, in our daily lives, we're obviously doing a lot more than just pressing buttons and turning knobs. We're coordinating our whole bodies to move throughout space to, again, achieve lots of different goals, whether it's joint actions with other people or just, you know, getting ourselves from point A to point B. So we approach the challenge of understanding these action perception links from the complete opposite end of the spectrum. And we look at very complex, very coordinated actions that involve the whole body to get a better handle on, you know, how these action perception links are shaping behavior in our everyday life. So today I've made the choice to focus a little bit more on breadth rather than depth of my research, just to give you a whistle-stop tour of some of the things that my team and I have been working on over the past few years. If there are any questions about some of these studies that I talk about and you'd like to probe them more deeply in questions, I'm more than happy to. But we'll start with just kind of a little tour of the highlights. So one research theme, and one of the first ones that we got into, and of course one that syncs up very well with research that goes on here at the Karolinska, are questions of action expertise. So we've been asking, how does action expertise modulate perception of others in action? We've also asked questions about observational learning or visual experience. So how might observation compare to physical experience in action learning? As I also mentioned, we've looked as well at non-human action, and this really lets us get at questions of how flexible social information processing is when we're looking at action and perception links, when we see agents who are very much not like us in either the way they move or what they look like. And finally, and perhaps most relevant to kind of the point of this culture and brain seminar series, we've also asked some pretty exciting questions recently about the relationship between aesthetic appreciation and embodiment. So what's going on when we're at the ballet or perhaps even at the opera, or it could even be a musical performance, how does your own experience as a spectator shape what it is you like to see others do or see in performers? So the first question is, how does action expertise shape perception? And the question we're really interested in here is, what goes on within the brain when you transition from a person who's kind of just starting off with learning let's say it's a new dance sequence, like these kids are here, when you transition to becoming really expert and really adept? So obviously there's a lot going on in your body when you kind of can't quite coordinate what it is you're trying to do in this position here, and then you move to being really fantastically skilled when you're finally at the performance stage. So yes, we are interested in how the acquisition of action expertise that's acquired through weeks of physical practice starts to shape the brain of the learner when they observe others performing these actions. So this is a slightly misleading picture, because we didn't use naive individuals in this study. Instead, what we used were 10 members of a professional contemporary dance company. So these were people who were really expert at dancing, but importantly, they weren't expert at the dance piece that we studied them learning. So these dancers were spending 8 weeks learning a very long, elaborate piece of choreography, a contemporary dance work called Skylight, as part of their repertory. So they were spending 5 days a week across these 8 weeks rehearsing this movement vocabulary, so a really intensive rehearsal process. And what we did is we brought the dancers into the brain imaging laboratory, and we scanned their brains once a week across 6 weeks of this 8-week rehearsal process. And what the dancers did while they were having their brain scanned was they watched a bunch of different dance sequences. So they had 36 different really small, really short video clips of dance sequences, and half of those sequences were movement vocabulary that they were rehearsing as part of the Skylight piece, and the other 18 movement sequences looked quite similar. They were kinematically similar. If you weren't in this dance company, you might not have noticed anything different between, you shouldn't have noticed anything different between this choreography, but it wasn't part of the movement vocabulary they were learning. So we had our experimental movement and our control movement. And our dancers, as they watched these movement sequences, their task was to watch them, to imagine how well they could perform each individual movement segment as it played. Then they'd press a button at the end to denote on a scale of 1 to 4, I could perform that very well right now, number 4 or number 1, I wouldn't be so good at performing that yet. And of course, we hoped to see, and we did see, that across the 8 weeks of rehearsing and the 6 weeks of testing, that their ratings of their ability to perform certainly went up over time. But just to highlight one or two small findings from this study, first of all, we can look at what's going on within the brains of our dancers as they watch this rehearsed movement compared to unrehearsed dance movements. And really nicely, what we see here is widespread engagement. This is just the left hemisphere of the brain I'm showing you here, but we saw it in the right hemisphere as well, of the action observation network when our dancers are watching movements that they've physically practiced compared to movements that they've not practiced. Now again, if I were to stick any of you in this room who don't know this choreography into the scanner, you wouldn't really see any brain activity here because all these movements would look the same to you and there would be no real big difference. But for these dancers, there was a really big difference in terms of how the action observation network's responding for those movements that are rehearsed compared to the unrehearsed movements. And this was a really nice kind of validation of and replication of the study that came out 1 year previously from Beatrice Calvamarino and colleagues, where they looked at professional ballet and capoeira dancers and had them watch movement that was within or beyond their own movement repertoire, and they had a very similar finding with what you're actually practicing is going to engage these brain regions much more. But the more exciting finding, I would argue, from this study concerns this parametric analysis we did, where we inquired, are there any brain regions, if we perform a whole brain analysis, that show an amplified response the better the perceiver is at performing that movement they're watching? So that might sound a bit complicated, but just to break it down, we're asking, are there, as you're watching these movements and reading them, some of them you're really good at and some you're not so good, and if we kind of weight the brain model or the brain data to say what brain regions are responding more robustly, the better you are at what you're watching, what we find is that there's not massive amounts of engagement all over the brain, but instead we see two brain regions and two brain regions only, and just in the left hemisphere, we have the inferior parietal lobule and the left ventral premotor cortex, so we have these really targeted, increases in activity within these two brain regions, and this suggests that the better you are at performing a movement, the more you simulate it, and these brain regions are kind of the seat of embodiment, if you want to think about it in that way. So that was a pretty exciting finding to show that our expertise, we have this really nice neural signature for it among this group of expert dancers. So a study we've done more recently to kind of follow up on some of that work, per se, was to shift gears slightly and to ask about the kind of implicit emotional or affective responses that expert and non-expert dance observers might have when they're watching other people dance. So we do know from a broad literature, looking at a manner of different really simple pedestrian actions like grasping bottles, which seems a bit strange, but we know that even when you're watching others perform really simple actions like that, that you can have emotional responses. Observers can respond in an emotional way. So that might sound a bit crazy, but if I reach forward to this clock and grab it like this, you'll have an emotional response in one way, but if I kind of reach in a really awkward way like this, you'll have a very different kind of implicit emotional response. And this can really tell us a lot about kind of how affective states change how we perceive others in action. But what we don't really know are how these subtle emotional responses and explicit ratings of perhaps your enjoyment of watching these types of movements might be influenced by kind of the baseline expertise you bring to the observing experience. So to test this, we used what's called an electromyography, or EMG, paradigm, and it looks a little bit like this. So we have these skin conductance types of electrodes connected to just above the eyebrow and on the cheek here. And what these electrodes allow us to do are to measure activity within the corrugator muscle. That's this muscle right here, and this is the muscle that you engage when you frown, as well as the zygomaticus muscle, and that's the one on your cheek, and you engage this muscle when you smile. And essentially the idea is that if you're watching a movement that you find really pleasant, that you have a positive affective response to, more activity should be engaged here in the zygomaticus muscle, and if you see an activity that, or a movement that, you know, kind of is boring or you don't like very much, there should be more engagement within the corrugator muscle. And importantly, the power of this technique is that if you're just to look at someone's face, you won't see anything. So people aren't actually smiling or scowling at these movements. Their faces are completely neutral. But what these electrodes allow us to do is to pick up on really sub-threshold, small movements that people don't know they're making when they're watching movements. So in this study, we had 25 expert dancers. They were mostly ballet dancers, but we also had some contemporary dancers as well. And we had a matched sample of 26 dance-naive observers. And what our participants did was they watched 108 videos, much like these you see here. They were 3 seconds each, and we had professional dancers from the Leipzig Ballet, and they performed a bunch of kind of contemporary dance and ballet movements. And just to, again, jump straight to the results, and I should also state that when the participants watched these videos, they didn't make any ratings about how well they liked them while they were having their muscle activity recorded. They only made ratings of how much they liked them after they came back to the laboratory after this recording was over. So they're kind of just simply passively observing, and we take ratings later. And what we find here, this top plot of graphs here, this is our non-dancers. These are our 26 individuals who have no dance experience. And we see that for the zygomaticus smiling muscle and the corrugator or frowning muscle, movements that they later rate as liked or disliked, there's no real discrimination between these movements for our unexperienced or our inexperienced observers. However, the bottom row here, this is the data from our dancers' EMG recordings, and here we have some pretty nice evidence that as time goes by, as our dancers are watching movements that they rate as liked, the zygomaticus muscle is more engaged, and when they watch those movies that they later rate as less liked, we see more engagement of the corrugator muscle. So we have this kind of first pass set of data to suggest that your ability to embody, you know, not necessarily these specific movements, but your kind of general movement expertise can really shape your affective or your emotional responses to watching others in action as well. So what we can conclude from these first two studies is that physical expertise in terms of one's ability to perform an observed movement can shape perception in terms of sharpening the responses within core nodes of this action observation network. And physical expertise can also facilitate some subtle and implicit affective facial responses when you're observing those movements. So we're starting to get just a few little ideas about how expertise is shaping perception among expert dance observers. So shifting gears a little bit to ask questions about, we looked at kind of physical expertise. We can also ask questions about how physical learning might compare to visual learning or learning from watching, not just learning from doing. So we know that it's the case that observational learning is a really important skill that humans have, and it's something that we capitalize on throughout our lifespan. It's not just for kids. We're doing it from pretty much the moment we're born through to old age. We're learning from watching others. There's a lot of behavioral evidence, there's a lot of behavioral research, especially in the sports science literature, that suggests that there's probably quite a few parallels and overlap between learning from watching versus learning by doing. But most of that behavioral work, the behavioral work is limited in that it can suggest that there's overlaps, but we don't really know kind of at a more systems level or at a more cellular level whether visual and physical learning are really sharing similar substrates. So what we hope to do in these experiments is to really probe that question in more depth. So in this first study, this is a very typical training paradigm that we use in the laboratory, where we'll have identical fMRI sessions on 2 days, and then in between those identical sessions, we'll have 5 to 6 days of behavioral training, and then participants will come back into the laboratory and we'll ask them to kind of perform all sorts of things that they'd either been training on or that remained untrained throughout this training period. So for this first study, we had 17 dance-naive adults. These are people who've never had any dance classes, and these are also people who've never played the dance video game that we used for this study. And we had 3 main training conditions that we focused on here, and this kind of gives you an idea of what our dance video game looked like. It's a really old one now. No one uses these anymore, but it was called Dance Dance Revolution. And what you're supposed to do is you're supposed to step on this dance pad here on the arrows, the same place that's indicated on this this top axis here. And it's good exercise. It's kind of fun. And for those dancers in the audience, you'll say, but it's not dance. And it's controversial as to whether or not it's dance, but you are coordinating your body to music and, you know, you're trying to perform a task, so it worked for our purposes. But essentially, we had one set of sequences that participants physically practiced each day, another set of sequences that were similar, and of course, counterbalanced across participants that they simply watched. They just passively observed, they weren't told to try to learn them, and a third set of sequences that remained untrained. And of course, in the surprise behavioral retest, we asked them to dance all of those sequences. So there were 6 sequences in each, they're asked to dance all 18. And what we see, again, just focusing on a small number of the results from this study, we see, perhaps not surprisingly, this is the behavioral data, that our participants perform on the surprise retest the best, those movements that they physically practiced, and the worst, those that were untrained, but the ones that they simply observed, they were able to perform at an intermediate level. So we get some evidence for observational learning, but it's of course not as strong as physical practice. But a little bit more excitingly, what this brain plot is showing you here is we have our left and our right hemispheres, and the red regions on the brain show brain regions that are more engaged when you're watching movements that you physically practiced compared to movements that are untrained, and the blue regions are showing brain regions that are more active when you're watching those movements that you just observed during the week of training compared to untrained actions, and the yellow shows overlap between physically practicing and watching. And what we see is kind of nice, widespread, not quite as widespread as our previous study, but we do get engagement of this action observation network, broadly defined, and we do see that in both the left parietal and the right dorsal premotor cortices, that both physical and visual experience seem to be impacting these regions in similar ways. So what we've done since that study is we've taken a leap into the 21st century somewhat, and we're using more sophisticated dance video game technology, and we're using the Dance Central video game, which you see right here, with the Xbox Kinect motion tracking technology. And there's of course much more sophisticated motion tracking technology you can use, and we use that as well, but this is actually a really fantastic tool for scientists to get an objective measure of physical performance on much more sophisticated dancing. So you remember in our first dance video game we had people kind of stepping on arrow patterns in time with music. Well, the stimuli from this study are a bit more sophisticated and look like this. Let's see if we'll have sound, I'm not sure. Yeah. So you can see it's whole body movements, there's a lot going on there. Some old classic songs as well. And these are just some stimuli. The actual sequences last a minute and a half, and what we do is we then kind of break the dances down to just individual movements, such as just going like this, or you know, all of the different options that there are. And to give you an idea of what this training paradigm looked like, very similar to the first one where we have two identical fMRI sessions, the dance test on the last day, and behavioral training in between. But this time we've added a third condition to the training. We have what we call physical, visual, and auditory training, where participants are dancing the whole body, they listen to the music, they can see the dancers on the screen. Then we have visual and auditory training, where participants sit there at a computer and they simply watch those videos like I just showed you on the previous screen, but the long versions of those. Then they have auditory training only, and we were wondering what might happen when participants just listen to the music, just listen to the soundtracks of these dances, but never actually see the movements associated with them. Then they come back into the lab on the final day of testing and we have them dance all of the sequences that came from these 3 training conditions plus 2 additional untrained ones. And to show you just, these are kind of slightly complicated plots, but I'm just going to focus on a few things here. What we're looking at here are brain regions from a whole brain analysis, and we have on this column here, this is all the pre-training data, so before participants have any training experience, it's the case that all of these dance sequences should be equally unfamiliar, and what these 4 bars are showing us is that they're flat, so there's no discrimination between movements that you're going to train on over a week. But then after training, this is the right bars here, in red, we have what's going on when our participants are watching those movements that they have physical experience, visual experience, and auditory experience moving to. The orange bars are just visual and auditory experience. This is the observational condition. The yellow bars here are auditory experience only, so just listening to the soundtrack. And then we have the untrained in green, and what you see are these really nice parametric effects that the more modalities through which you've trained to learn something. So you had vision, you had audition, you had physical practice. Those red bars are the strongest, and then as soon as you take modalities away, one by one, you see a decrease in engagement in all three of these action observation network regions, which was quite nice to see, this idea about building learning experience through different modalities. And this final plot from this study just kind of looks at this in a little bit more detail and kind of looks at this overlap between physical learning, essentially in red, and observational learning in orange, and the overlap is in purple. And here we see that there are a few regions, but one in particular, the left premotor cortex, does show no differentiation between these three types of training before any experience, which makes sense, but then afterwards we see that both physical and visual experience impact this brain region in a really similar way and much more so compared to untrained sequences. So some nice evidence to suggest that the behavioral data that suggests that observational learning and physical learning do share some overlap. We have some brain data to say that yes, this is perhaps more so the case than might have originally been thought. So what we can conclude from this line of work, and again, we have some other ongoing work, is that visual experience alone can very much shape sensory motor brain regions. Yes, we find, as most people do as well, that it's not as effective as actually practicing physically, but visual experience can, you know, it's not doing nothing. It's certainly changing the brain in some quite marked ways. We think this has a lot of exciting implications for bolstering learning for those who can't physically practice, or perhaps maintaining learning for those who can't practice, such as perhaps an individual who's had a stroke, but not just that, perhaps someone who has broken an arm or a leg and can't, you know, rehearse with their dance company or rehearse in some other sort of physical context. If you simply watch, it could be the case that you'll keep these connections ticking over. And there is some ongoing work in our laboratory as part of a large project that's using more sophisticated analytical techniques to kind of get at the patterns or the representations of physical and visual learning. And we're looking at this among groups of young adolescents, young adults, and older adults to kind of track the fingerprint of observational learning throughout the lifespan. And hopefully there'll be some results coming out of that very soon. Okay. So shifting gears to the penultimate topic here, I said that we're also going to talk about how it is we make sense of dissimilar others and not just, you know, our own experience, using our own experience to watch and understand other people moving around us. So what I've talked about mostly so far are these dance movements, and we have either expert dancers or novice dancers, and they're kind of using their own experience to make sense of the dancers they see on a video screen. And we can think again about lots of different examples in our daily lives, and we see people doing all manner of things that we can understand that woman's walking, that girl's shooting a basketball, and that chap's dancing. But we can also come across in our daily lives all manner of actions and agents that move in ways that most of us could never imagine moving in, such as ice skaters in the Olympics, robots that you might see in films, professional dancers or Paralympians, individuals that have prosthetic limbs that most of us don't have ourselves. And if we use this idea that we use our own experience to make sense of others, you might ask the question, how is it that we're able to so effortlessly make sense of those agents that look or move in ways entirely different from us? So there's a theory that called the like me hypothesis, and it posits that the dominant model of the action observation network is that this network is seeking out others, other agents and other actions in the environment that are similar to me, and when I see those agents and actions, I can make sense of them, and that's kind of how this works. And that this action observation network is really kind of highly evolved to seek out self-other equivalences in the environment. So I make sense of other people much more readily if they look or move like me. But there's also some studies, and just from that slide I showed you previously with C3PO and with Olympic ice skaters and dancers and Paralympians, that we can make sense of these agents that don't really move or look like us. There's also some studies that have been coming out over the past 8 years or so that suggest this action observation network is also quite engaged when we view non-human agents or actions that are very much not like me, and this implies a lot more flexibility in information processing. So What we wanted to do in this set of studies is to put social perception to the test and to test the limits of the action observation network when you perceive agents or actions that are very much not like me, in terms of what they move, in terms of what they look like or how they move, and this will hopefully allow us to understand this flexibility question in more detail. So in this study, this was actually a study that had two experiments. I'll just tell you about one. We had a 2x2 factorial design, and we had a human breakdancer who was just doing some simple movements, as you can see up here in the top left. But then we also went to the toy store and bought a Lego robot, which you can see right here. This is an action figure that stands about this high. And I had a very talented research assistant who did stop motion cinematography and frame by frame matched the movements of the human dancer with the Lego robot. And then we put them all together to make these little videos. And we also had our human dancer. He was, I'm showing you a simple one here, but he was a professional breakdancer and he was a fantastic robot dancer. So we had him move in a much more mechanical way that would be very unfamiliar to our participants as well. And then of course we animated our Lego action figure to do those same movements. So in this way we can pair off, or we can play off each other, questions about form, so human form and robotic form, and motion, so kind of more familiar human-like motion, and then more kind of rigid, jerky robotic motion. And in the scanner, what we had our participants do, we had 23 dance-naive participants, some participants who've never done robot dancing in a club or anything like that before, so they're just kind of everyday Joes and Janes that don't really have experience with what they're seeing, and they watched a whole bunch of these stimuli, a bunch of different ones. And after 25% of the trials, a little question mark would pop up, and then they'd see a little two-second probe video, and their task was to decide, did that probe video come from that previously seen video, yes or no? This was just a really simple attention manipulation, because you could imagine one of our concerns was that when you see this dancing Lego man, that's going to be so much more interesting, and people's attention is really going to be attracted to that. They might not really pay attention to this guy, or vice versa. So we wanted to make sure that people were kind of paying attention throughout. And this plot here just shows that people are at ceiling accuracy, so they're not really watching one more than another. And then we can ask questions about what's going on in the brain when you're watching. We're going to focus on the kind of the different movement profiles, so the more kind of smooth and natural dance movement compared to the really rigid and jerky robot movement. But first we just need to do a sanity check, and we can say, what's going on when you're watching that kind of natural dance compared to baseline? And here we see widespread activation of the action observation network, and we see the same thing when you're watching the robotic dance compared to baseline. So that essentially means when you're watching a figure move on the screen compared to a blank screen, you're seeing widespread engagement of the action observation network. That's just what we would expect. That's not surprising. That just lets us know that, you know, we've modeled things correctly. But of course, the much more interesting question is, what happens when you compare these two types of stimuli, these two types of action? And here, when we look at what's going on in our participants' brains when they're watching the more natural, familiar movement compared to that weird, rigid, robotic movement, according to the like me hypothesis, the natural movement is far more like me than the robotic movement, so we should have widespread activation of the action observation network. We get nothing. However, the inverse of this, when you're watching the more unfamiliar, unlike me robotic movement compared to the natural movement, here we see very robust, very widespread engagement, especially in the parietal cortex, but a little bit in the premotor and the occipitotemporal as well, for the robotic compared to natural movement. So this was really surprising, so much so that I didn't trust the data at first, and we replicated this experiment with a naive group of participants before we published it, just to make sure that we hadn't mixed anything up, and indeed we showed the same thing again. And the one other result I'd like to highlight from this, which I think is quite interesting, is we also were able to look at interactions. So just to break this down in a really simple way, we're able to ask, are there parts of the brain that care about coherent pairings? So when the human moves like a human and the robot moves like a robot, compared to the weird or the incoherent pairings, not incoherent, but the slightly strange pairings. So when the human moves like a robot or the robot moves like a human. And when we run this analysis, we see that one brain region, and one brain region only, which is a little hard to see, but it's right here in the left temporal parietal junction, this brain region seems to be more engaged when people are watching the human moving like a human and the robot moving like a robot compared to the kind of slightly strange pairings. And the reason why this is interesting, there's several reasons, but one that's particularly striking is after we ran this fMRI experiment in two sets of human adult participants, We then ran an FNIRS version, or a functional near-infrared spectroscopy version, in very small 4-month-old infants. And we had these infants watching those exact same videos I just showed you, and we just kind of recorded activity within the infants' brains. And what this data, that there's, again, quite a few results from this study, but one that's, I think, really interesting is that there's a set of diodes here that's very similar to the region that we have with our adult brains that shows this exact same response, where when the human's moving like a human and the robot's moving like a robot, the diodes here are showing the most blood flow compared to the human moving like a robot or the robot moving like a human. And the reason that's interesting, of course, is that at 4 months of age, our infants don't have a lot of experience with, certainly not with moving their own bodies in any of these ways, but also without really seeing other agents moving in these types of ways. So I think there's something potentially interesting about the innate nature of, you know, how agents and actors might be moving in our environment. And this is something that we do want to follow up on, but nice to have a developmental perspective. So what we can conclude from this making sense of dissimilar others line, we're looking to ask questions about social experience, shaping perception of those that are like me or not like me, and we find strong evidence kind of against the like me hypothesis. I think there's a lot of really interesting and important theoretical implications for how social perception is going on and what the flexibility of social perception is. And we have a new project right now that's just kicking off in the laboratory, which is going to look at how long-term interactions start to shape kind of this like-me relationship and how we perceive artificial agents. So watch this space for more on that. So I'll wrap up with one final set of very briefly going into studies on neuroaesthetics, because this stuff, I think, again, for those of you interested in art, become a little bit more exciting and interesting. So for those of you not familiar with neuroaesthetics, this is kind of a new and very much ascending field that seeks, or a discipline that seeks to identify brain processes that underlie and perhaps might help to explain aesthetic appreciation in observers. And it's been mostly this field, there's a lot that's been done with music, there's a lot that's been done with paintings, and there's been just a little bit that's looked into dance. And I think what's interesting about dance and aesthetics is there's really, really important questions to be asked again about embodiment and how your abilities might shape how you perceive in others moving, and then how that impacts how much you like others. And some of the first work was also done by Beatrice Calvamarino and colleagues, and they suggest a possible role for not just visual regions, but sensory motor regions in the aesthetic response to dance. So again, our biggest interest is in this embodiment question. So we want to disentangle embodiment and liking when watching others dance. So in one study we did with this, we had participants in the brain scanner, again, watching a bunch of these videos of our professional ballet dancers performing a number of different movements. And we did this first study with dance-naive adults, young adults. And then they were asked after each question, after each video, one of two questions. They were either asked, how much did you like that video you just watched on a 1-4 scale, or how well could you perform this video you just watched? And we found several interesting things, but one of the most interesting things, which kind of goes against some of the aesthetics, empirical aesthetics literature, is that our participants really liked most those movements that they absolutely could not do. So when they saw the dancer bring her leg right up to her ear like this and, you know, stand vertically in the air, that was far more enjoyable for them to watch than when the dancer kind of did movements that they could do themselves with their own body. So they really liked the more impressive movements, which I think makes intuitive sense, but there's a lot of aesthetics work that suggests we like what we know or what we can do. That's not quite what we find here. And in terms of what we find in the brain, we do find that there are visual regions that are kind of more engaged when you're watching movements that you like a lot but cannot do. But interestingly as well, we see that there is this region of the right intraparietal sulcus, which also shows a really strong response to, you know, pleasure at watching movements, even though the embodiment is really low. So that's quite interesting. And the final study I'll highlight in this, we also use the same Xbox Kinect dance training paradigm. And again, this, you know, we had fMRI studies, fMRI scans before and after this intensive training period, but we also ask our participants to rate how much they like watching all these movements. And here we see that, again, this was a similar, this was identical training paradigm to that one I spoke about with the other Xbox study. where there is physical experience, visual experience, auditory, and untrained. And we see that they perform best on those that they physically practiced, sure, but what we see as well here, if we subtract their pre-training ratings, which are taken here at the first day of testing, from their post-training ratings, what we see is that if they've spent time physically practicing, they actually end up liking stuff a lot more. Yes, they can reproduce it more too, but they also like more those movements that they just watched. So those videos where they sat and watched and they never physically practiced them, they end up liking those better too. Slightly sad for the music part of our manipulation, they end up liking less, though not significantly, the songs that they just listened to the soundtracks in, but I think that probably speaks to our choice of songs and nothing to do with music and experience overall, of course. Right, and we do find some interesting differences in neural modulation with aesthetics in this study as well. So we can look at what's going on in the brain when we do a parametric analysis of what brain regions are showing more engagement the more you like something. And here we see that the subthalamus and nucleus accumbens, so kind of some more subcortical regions, are really engaged with liking pre-training. And post-training, we see that this kind of relationship goes out to more biological motion perception areas, so STS, which is quite interesting. And I think when you kind of compare this finding to the previous one, we see that the relationship between what we can do and what we like watching is nonlinear, it's subtle, and it's complex. And I guess maybe this is frustrating for for non-scientists to say, like, oh, well, you find one thing in one study and different things in another study. I think that speaks to the complexity of this, and it's also a challenge for us as scientists to kind of figure out how all of these things fit together. And we do see that with experience, with more and more experience, this relationship starts to change. And we have a kind of a work group with a bunch of, with some dancers from the Forsyth Company in Frankfurt, and they're really interested in this relationship between embodiment and aesthetics, and there's some ongoing work right now where we're trying to pick apart this relationship in more detail. So, to summarize what we've learned throughout all of this, our aim was to explore how different kinds of experience shape brain function and how we perceive others moving around us in a social world. And what we see happening is that even though we're not actually asking ourselves these questions, the brain's making a bunch of different computations when we see others in actions. It's computing, can I do what I see that other person doing? Have I seen that before? Does that individual or does that agent look or move like me? And do I like watching that? Kind of the findings in a nutshell suggest that our prior experiences, as well as our expectations, can profoundly shape how we perceive others, with measurable, long-standing changes in brain function, and also connectivity, though I didn't talk about the connectivity to data today, reflect individuals' each unique experience profile. And yeah, we have a lot of next steps that are going on, and we're hoping to explore the impact of this experience-dependent plasticity on learning and behavior, course, in more depth, with lots of potentially interesting long-term impacts on the recovery of function after stroke, perhaps, and also cultivating grassroots support for the performing arts. That's a pet project or a pet hope of mine. And of course, as I said, with some of this robot stuff, facilitating human-robot interaction. So I had two other slides on music stuff, but I appreciate it's been 50 minutes, so I think I will wrap it up there, and we can maybe talk about that in the next part. But thank you very much for your attention.